Father God, I ask your blessing upon our teaching today. I pray, Father, that what we say is going to really sink into our hearts and realize the evil that's happening in our world today. And so, God, help me as I teach, I pray. In Jesus' name. Oh, I want to also pray for Diana here, who's going in for surgery tomorrow. And so I just pray, God, that you bless the doctors and nurses. I pray, God, that the stroke that she had some time back, they're dealing with that. And I pray, God, that everything comes through in a great way because you are the physician and you are in charge of that surgery. I praise you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Here's the words of Jesus from Mark chapter 10, verse 8. But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. That's pretty direct, isn't it? We have seen in recent weeks the great controversies over the transgender movement. The Bud Light commercial featuring transgender Dylan McIlhenny ended up costing Budweiser so far, now it's $27 billion, not 18, it was 18 when I typed this. It's now up to $27 billion. Budweiser is now pleading for her customers to come back. Then there's Target featuring transgender clothing, placing it at the entrance of the store in honor of Pride Month, which of course is this month of June. That created such a backlash that they were forced to move the clothing to the back of the store and reduce attention to it out of fear that the same thing would happen to them that happened to Budweiser. Some of this clothing is from a Pride collection whose clothing is satanically inspired, and Target knew it. Target lost $9 billion in 1 week because of a boycott. I don't know how much now, but $9 billion in 1 week. That would hurt. Then the Los Angeles Dodgers at Pride Night and invited an anti-Catholic drag queen group who pose as queer and trans nuns of the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence. You realize that they put on a performance mocking the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. The Catholic Church is launching a $1 million ad campaign to encourage people to boycott the Dodgers, as there is no place for anti-Catholic bigotry. Megyn Kelly reported on a trans woman, remember that's a biological male, who is suing a New York City yoga studio for forcing him to use the men's locker room. Oh. Then we have female athletes like Riley Gaines protesting against competing with trans women in swimming, like Leah Thomas as an example. There are former trans teens, like Violet Jane, who are suing medical providers like Kaiser Permanente over double mastectomy at age 13 years of age. I could go on. This is just a small example of what has been happening in our trans world lately. Now, the book that I'm going to be using through this lesson, though more of the second half of it, is called Irreversible Damage, The Transgender Craze, Seducing Our Daughters, written by Abigail Shire. I think it's a must read for today's parents, especially those with adolescent children. Now, I don't have the book physically with me because I get all of my books on Kindle, and so therefore, that's where I read the entire book. Abigail Shire is a writer for the Wall Street Journal and has degrees from the University of Oxford and Yale Law School. This book has caused great controversy, especially from the trans community and those who support the transgender movement. She writes of all the opposition to her book even before it was sold or even read by anyone. This book must not be sold, fled the letters that flooded her publisher, Regency Publishing. Their complaint was, transgender children are not accepted or affiliated or affirmed by their family. Let's read that again. Transgender children who are not accepted or affirmed by their family have extremely high rates of depression, addiction, and suicide. This book will only contribute to the crisis among transgender youth. Amazon barred her publisher from sponsoring ads on the spurious grounds that the book claims to diagnose, treat, or question sexual orientation. 4 months after the book was published and selling briskly, a Twitter user wrote to Target, stating this book was a harmful product that needed to be pulled from the shelf. Shortly afterwards, the book was pulled from Target.com. The American Civil Liberties Union, known as the ACLU, tweeted, Abigail Shire's book is a dangerous polemic with a goal of making people non-trans. A member of the ACLU also said, stopping the circulation of this book and these ideas is 100% a hill I will die on. A professor of English at the University of California, Berkeley, went further, tweeting, I do encourage followers to steal Abigail Shire's book and burn it on a prop. That's for you cremated people. I listen frequently to Charlie Kirk and his talks at college campuses. I would say the subject most discussed in recent years has to do with transgenderism and the attempts on the part of students to silence his talks. The same can be said of Michael Knowles and Ben Shapiro, all who hold fast to a biblical worldview that there are only two genders, male and female, and it was never God's plan for a boy to become a girl or a girl to become a boy. Without question, transgenderism is the hottest topic on college campuses and social media. I would say the pro-life, pro-choice debate is right up there as well. From a 2021 survey of Canadian college students comes this quote. Transgender and gender diverse youth emerge as the groups at the highest level of violent radicalization known as VR. I want you to notice that the phrase violent radicalization is now termed VR. So when you have it has to be pretty prominent to get initials. This is in line with the results of a recent survey conducted during the pandemic that highlighted high levels of support for VR as well as psychological distress among gender minorities. Psychological stress is common among transgender people, with surveys indicating about 30% of them attempt suicide. Notice now the transgender movement is based on neo-Marxism. It's us versus them. There's an attempt on the part of neo-Marxists to silence all talk against the transgender movement, which could result in violent radicalism. So I want you to see now the rise of violent radicalism, or VR. There's an article I read in the Epoch Times, May of this year, and the article was titled, Transgender Ideology Elevates Risk of Violent Radicalization, Experts Say. The article refers to the March 28, 2023 school shooting in Nashville, Tennessee, when 19-year-old Audrey Elizabeth Hale shot dead 6 people, including 3 children at the Covenant School, a private Presbyterian Christian school. Hale was a male who identified as a female. The week after the shooting, she was arrested for attempted murder of a police officer in her Colorado home, and her Colorado home was found detailed plans for multiple school shootings. Surveys in recent years have revealed an elevated potential for radicalization among us and them. So the hatred now of transgenders toward white cisgenders. Do you know that you are a cisgender? Did you know that?
No.
And what we're going to do now, we're going to define what a cisgender is. Everyone in this room can identify, that's who I am. Now notice the Epoch Times article continues. The belief among experts says it is an us versus them. According to Philip Carl Salzman, emeritus professor of anthropology at McGill University, that's in Canada. I quote him now, the political narrative around transgenderism posits that gender diverse are fundamentally at odds with people willing to live with their innate sex, who are called cisgender. It's a neo-Marxist model that divides society into oppressors and victims and characterizes the victims as innocent and the oppressors as evil. So we're evil. So people who identify as victims feel justified in hating the category of people who are alleged to be their oppressors. This paradigm, I'm still quoting Salzman here, this professor, has been applied to Marxism, to class, by critical race theory to race, by radical feminism to sex, and by queer theory to gender. This kind of worldview then fuels resentment, opposition, hate, and potentially to violence. It's a paranoid mindset in the sense that all of your troubles are the result of what other people do to you. So my problems are not my problems, they are problems that have been foisted on me. Salzman says there is the idea among trans, these trans people, that there is a campaign to kill trans people, which is totally imaginary and totally paranoid. In general, cisgendered people are considered evil and unsupportive, regardless of their actual views on the topic. To be heterosexual, now here's the definition of a cisgender. To be heterosexual, comfortable with the gender you were assigned at birth, and a non-minority, gotta be white, places you in the most evil of categories. Statement of opinions by the evil cisgendered population are considered phobic and discriminatory and are generally discounted as unenlightened. So we are transphobic, we discriminate, and we're not very intelligent. That's who we are.
The deplorables.
We're the deplorables, yeah. Hillary fits that. Now, this is the reason why some experts see a violent radicalization of transgenderism, like the Nashville murders of teachers and children in a Christian school, to be the wave of the future. What we know thus far is this. Anyone who speaks out against transgenderism risks getting canceled, called evil, and a transphobe. Ultimately, the hatred of transgenders toward those who claim to be who their gender is at birth, that's those of us known as cisgender, will lead to violent radicalization. Transgenderism is the most protected and radicalized cultural norm at this time in our nation's history, though, as I said earlier, the pro-choice, pro-life debate is right up. These are the two major issues of our time morally. Now, we need to understand this whole movement. And that's what I'm going to introduce you to. Keep in mind, this lesson today is kind of an introduction to what I want to talk about next week. So this just kind of sets the tone for where we're going next week, because as I said earlier, we're going to look at the theology of people who call themselves Christian that are transgendered people. Okay, let's talk now about the culture. That's the point now, the culture of gender neutrality. That's where we're headed. The transgender movement is all part of the cultural battle to obliterate sexual distinctions. The Judeo-Christian view is that man and woman are distinct beings, and that civilization rests in large measure on preserving the male-female distinction. That is why Genesis mentions the creation of male and female only with regard to human beings, not with regard to the creation of animals, even though obviously God also created male and female animals. The LGBTQ agenda is not only about sympathy for those individuals who feel alienated from the biological sex in which they were born. It is about getting rid of the male-female distinction. That is why biological men who claim to be a woman can compete in biological sports. Trans rights beat girls' rights. Biological boys identifying as girls are already overpowering their very best female athletes in swimming, track and field, weightlifting, and on we could go. In February 2019, tennis great and proud lesbian Martina Navratilova wrote for the Sunday Times that allowing trans athletes to compete in women's sports was unfair to biological women. She was labeled a transphobe and dropped by her sponsor, Athlete Alley. People today cannot even define who a woman is. Supreme Court Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson, when asked by Tennessee Senator Marsha Blackburn, "What is a woman?" Jackson was unable to answer the question. Yet this woman sits on the highest court of the land. If a woman can no longer be defined according to physical characteristics or biology, how are we to define them? I'm going to give you what they say about that. Prominent transgender author Andrea Long Chow has an answer. Now here is what a woman is. See, if you ladies like this. Female is a universal existential condition defined by submitting to someone else's desires. That's who you are. Let me read that. I'm gonna explain this. But here's what she says. A female is a universal existential condition defined by submitting to someone else's desires. In other words, what she's saying is this. Biology has nothing to do with defining a woman. Rather, it has everything to do with one's experiences in life and how they feel about their bodies, while others tell them differently, and so most women simply accept how others refer to them. Another way of putting it is like this. The definition of a woman is a human being who is confused about her body. She thinks one thing about herself, that is, she was born in the wrong body, while others tell her she is a woman simply based on her biological makeup. So you ladies here now, understand something. The reason why you know you are a woman is because people tell you you are a woman based on your makeup, but you may not be a woman because you may feel like you are in the wrong body. Do you understand the stupidity of where we are headed? Now let me tell you, this is my opinion. This is my opinion. I've heard a little bit about it. Where are we headed from here? Where?
Animalism.
Well, let's put it in there. Let's bestiality. You might as well, you know. Bible talks about that, having sex with animals.
Pedophilia,
we're heading there. Let's even extend it further. I like what you're coming up with. I'm going to say the time is going to come when there is a group of people who will not even call themselves human beings. You understand that? Yeah. These are the people who think they are smarter than we are. These are the woke people, as we call them. And these are the people that think we are so enlightened we have advanced way beyond the ordinary human being. And so we're no longer called human beings. I didn't put that in your notes because, anyway. Well, when that happens, we'll talk about it. I hope I'm not around then.
Jesus.
Now, can you imagine? I'm going back to this definition of a woman by Andrea Chow. Can you imagine a more offensive or insipid definition of womanhood? What the trans movement is seeking to do is to strip women of their biological uniqueness. Pregnant women are increasingly referred to as pregnant people because a woman who identifies as a man can also get pregnant. Hence, we are living in a time when trans men can get pregnant. Who would have ever thought? 10 years ago, 5 years ago, would you have imagined what we're talking about today? So biological women are being used today to disgrace their unique biological construction. It is a means of obliterating different genders so as to create gender neutrality. Scripture says this again, Genesis 1:27. So God created man in his own image, in the image of God he created him, male and female he created them. But the trans world says, that's not so. I heard one trans person say in a debate with Charlie Kirk, now get this now, that God created three genders, male, female, and them. Now, let me read the scripture again, because they're basing it on Genesis 1:27. So God created man in his own image, in the image of God he created him, male and female he created them. So there's male, female, and them. Okay, the trans people are them. Let's talk about the strategy now to separate sex from gender, because this is the big deal today. I listen to a lot of this stuff. I mean, my mind is saturated with it because I think every day I'm on the YouTube and this is the kind of stuff I'm getting. So I'm taking notes as I go along. You know? One of the strategies of the LGBTQ is to separate sex from gender. Sex is normally understood to be based on a person's genitals and reproductive organs. These anatomical details are thought to define a person as male and female. This is no longer the case. They only define one's sex. Gender is normally understood as classifying one as male or female based on their biological sex. No longer is that so. Rather, gender refers to one's preferred gender identity, how they feel in their own body. If a female feels like they were born in the wrong body, they may choose to identify their gender as male, even though their biological sex is female. Each individual can determine their own gender identity, be it male, female, or one of more than 70 to 100 other choices. Biology has everything to do with one's sex, but nothing to do with one's gender. That's the thinking. Now, in October 2017, get this now, the state of California enacted a law that threatened jail time for health care workers who refused to use patients' required gender pronouns. New York has adopted a similar law which applied to employers, landlords, business owners. Both laws are thoroughly unconstitutional because the First Amendment has long protected the right to say unpopular things without government interference. It also guarantees the right to refuse to say things the government once said. For example, the government cannot force students to salute the flag. They can even burn the flag if they choose. That is their right to free speech. Now, if the government cannot force students to say the Pledge of Allegiance, they can't force a healthcare worker or a landlord or a school teacher to utter a particular pronoun. In America, the government can't make people say things, not even for the sake of politeness, but when it comes to transgenderism, they are forcing people to say what they want to believe. Understand? Yeah. In today's world, it is considered, you'll crack up, maybe. Except it's too sad. In today's world, it is considered politically correct for a doctor to deliver a baby boy and call the baby a boy simply based on the fact that he has a penis. Only the child has the say-so as to their true gender. Thus, politically correct parents are raising children with no sexual identity, giving the child a gender-neutral name like Chris, for example, which later on, at the child's discretion, becomes Christopher or Christine, whatever gender the child chooses. At the time of birth, get this now, these parents who choose not to refer to their newborn by their biological sex refer to their baby as babies. T-H-E-Y-B-I-E-S. This is not a baby I'm holding, this is a babies. Okay? It's a new word. As the child grows a little older, they are referred to as non-binary. I have a non-binary child here, see? He doesn't know if he's a male or a female. I don't know if he's a male or a female or a them, see? That's what our parents, that's what's going on. These progressive parents will dress their child with mixed clothing, sometimes in a dress, other times in boys' clothing. They give their child mixed toys to play with, dolls and toy trucks. These parents do not want to impose a gender on their child, but rather have the child later in life make the choice for themselves. Now, they have to learn very quickly. When a biological boy, for example, begins to throw dolls around or play war with them, while biological girls hold their dolls and nurture them, that child is either a girl or a boy based upon how they handle these toys, see? Imagine a parent raising a child not knowing the gender of that child. That's the America we live in, far different one than you and I were raised. Now I'm going to get into Abigail Shire's book here. A bunch of what I'm going to say now comes from her book. So let's look and see what this is all about, because it's, as I said, a very, very, very important book that you might want to get and read much more extensively than this lesson provides. Abigail Shire wrote an article in the Wall Street Journal under the heading "The Transgender Language War," it's called. A mother, having read the article, contacted Abigail regarding her transgender daughter, who as a child showed no signs of gender dysphoria. She was a very typical girl. When she reached adolescence, her daughter began to question her sexual identity with the help of the internet, which provides an endless array of transgender mentors who coach you on how to slip into a new identity. What to wear, how to walk, how to gesture, how to speak. What to say. It's all taught right on the internet. Furthermore, which internet companies sell the best breast binders? That's a breast compressor garment worn under your clothes, so your breast doesn't display itself too much. Further, which organizations send transgender items for free with guaranteed discreet packaging so the parents never find out? How to persuade doctors, that's what the internet's doing, how to persuade doctors to supply hormones you want, how to deceive parents, or if they resist your new identity, how to break away from them entirely. The number one warning from Abigail about keeping your child from following through with the thought of changing their gender is don't give your child an iPhone. Now let's talk about the contagion of transgenderism. Why is it becoming such a big thing today when 10 years ago, you wouldn't have known anything about it? Gender dysphoria is characterized by a severe and persistent discomfort in one's biological sex. It typically begins in early childhood, ages 2 to 4, though it may grow more severe in adolescence. Over time, 70% of children will grow out of this sexual discomfort. Gender dysphoria is real, though it affects a tiny sliver of the population, roughly about 0.1%, and at first almost exclusively boys. This is interesting now, how boys were the first to want to become girls before girls ever wanted to become boys. Shire writes this, before 2012, there was no scientific literature on girls 11 to 21 ever having developed gender dysphoria at all. Go back to 2012. In the last decade, that has changed, and dramatically, she says, for the first time in medical history, natal girls are not only among those so identified, they constitute the majority. Now more girls want to become guys than guys want to become girls. We're going to tell you why as we move through this lesson. According to Ben Shapiro, you don't have this in your notes because I just got it this morning and I typed it in. According to Ben Shapiro, this is amazing. 21% of people born between 1998 and 2004 identify as LGBTQ. I got this wrong here. I got a Q instead of a G. I got to get that. There we go. Oh, come on here, Keller.
What percentage?
I'll get it. It's 21%. Ben Shapiro. 21% of people born between 1998 and 2004. You can realize that's one out of every five. One out of every five kids born during that time now identify as part of the LGBTQ+. You can see the contagion of this. That's what we're making. That's the point. Now, here's the question. Why has this happened? And the question now that Abigail is raising is, why did the sex ratio flip from overwhelming boys to majority adolescent girls? Abigail wrote an article in the Wall Street Journal, and it was entitled, "When Your Daughter Defies Biology." It provoked 1,000 comments and hundreds of responses to those comments. Abigail sums up those responses, which formed the basis of her book, which I've talked to you about. Listen to this quote from Abigail. This is such a significant quote. She says, "This is the story Americans need to hear. Whether or not you have an adolescent daughter who has fallen for this transgender craze, America has become fertile ground for this mass enthusiasm for reasons that have everything to do with, notice, our cultural frailty." Now she's defining what she means by cultural frailty. Parents are undermined and not respected. They don't stand up for themselves. Experts are over relied upon. Dissenters in science and medicine are intimidated. Free speech truckles under renewed attack. Government health care laws harbor hidden consequences. And an intersectional has arisen in which the desire to escape a dominant identity encourages individuals to take cover in victim groups. Understand that? That needs to be rethought through because that's our culture today. That's our culture today. We have a frail culture, as she's putting it. Kids don't respect their parents. Free speech is under attack. Government health care laws harbor hidden consequences. And then these people identify themselves as victims. They don't take responsibility for their actions. I'm simply a victim. Abigail concludes with her study saying, it originates not in traditional gender dysphoria, but in videos, get this, in videos found on the internet. It represents mimicry, that is an act of copying others, inspired by internet gurus, a pledge taken with girlfriends. So here's two girls, they hold hands, they hold their breath, they close their eyes, and they take an agreement here. For these girls, trans identification offers freedom from anxiety's relentless pursuit. It satisfies the deepest need for acceptance, the thrill of transgenderism, the seductive lilt of belonging. They want to belong, see? So, let's understand the reason for this contagion toward transgenderism, especially among girls. So, why? We note first, depression from social media loneliness. The iPhone and social media have caused adolescents to spend far less time in person with other peers, up to an hour less per day, than did members of the Gen X. That's the 1965 to 1980 group. Now, members of the Gen Z, that's people born from 1997 to 2012. This I found astounding. People born in that age group, the Gen Z group, are less likely to go to parties, hang out with friends, go on a date, go on a car ride, head to the shopping malls, or even go to a movie than those of previous generations. When they do meet up in person, hear me now, when they do meet up in person, they are much more likely to bring along a parent. Man, I wanted to get away from my mom and dad. I wanted to be free. Yeah? I didn't want my mother and dad looking at everything I'm doing. I bet you that's you. Now I've got to have a parent along. Well, the problem is the parents, some of the problem. They report greater loneliness. Now these people born between 1997 and 2012, they report greater loneliness than any generation on record. Adolescent girls who historically face life's challenges in pairs and groups are now more likely to face them alone. The reason for the transgender contagion, number two here. Teenage girlhood in America is almost synonymous with the worry that their body does not measure up. With the release of the iPhone in 2007, anorexia, cutting, that is deliberately hurting yourself because you hate who you are, and suicide have all spiked dramatically. When one is cruelly unforgiven of their own bodies, unforgiving, when one is cruelly unforgiving, I should say, of their own bodies, it begins to enter their mind that they are in the wrong body. Maybe they are not a girl after all. They would be happier and more accepted by others if they took on a different gender. The most popular and accepted students on a school campus today are those who have had the courage to change their gender. Before, they were a nobody, maybe even bullied. Now they are the most popular students on campus, and yet the irony of it is they feel lonely. The reason for transgender contagion, here's another reason. Teenage girls are physically safer today, you'll see why we mean that, yet they are more mentally vulnerable. Since the early 1990s, we reached the high water mark with teenage pregnancy. That's a good thing now. Today, teenage sex has reached a multi-decade low. Many teens have never been on a date or had a kiss. At the same time, they are facing mental health crises, reaching record levels of anxiety and depression. Currently, teenage girls are experiencing depression three times that of teenage boys. Self-harm has spiked 62% since 2009. All among teenage girls. The Atlantic, a magazine, liberal magazine, by the way, reported on this teenage girl's depression and said this. Here's the quote from The Atlantic. It's not an exaggeration to describe iGen or the Gen Z as being on the brink of the worst mental health crisis in decades. Much of this deterioration can be traced to their phones. That's a secular magazine. So confused are adolescent girls that the most common response that Abigail receives from her interviews with them is this. I don't exactly want to be a guy. I just don't want to be a girl. Only 12% of natal females who identify as transgender have undergone or even desire phalloplasty. This is what it means. They have no plans to obtain the male appendage that most people would consider as defining the feature of manhood. Sexual confusion based on their high rate of anxiety and depression is leading them toward a transgender lifestyle. Here's another reason for transgender contagion. There's no such thing as a tomboy or a lesbian today. Tomboys were girls who excelled at sports and preferred the company of boys. Being a masculine girl today no longer exists. They transitioned to boys. The whole concept of being a lesbian no longer exists either. It was Julia Roberts, a prominent gay writer, who said, "The new idea is that lesbians who look more masculine are really boys." So if a person identifies as a lesbian, what the trans world is saying, you're a boy. You're not a lesbian, you're a boy. Young lesbians or masculine looking girls are being pressured to think of themselves not as a girl, but as a boy. Therefore, go trans! Take on the physical appearance and actions of who you really are. See, that's the pressure that's being put on people who would say, oh, you know, I'm a tomboy or I'm a lesbian. No, you're boys. Notice another reason for transgender contagion. It's easier to be a boy than a girl. Puberty is a trial for anyone, especially girls. Cramping and bloating and acne all conspire to confirm to you that your body really hates you. There's always the fear that crushing pain and the sudden flow of blood, the horror that she may have leaked through her genes halfway through a social studies exam. The average age when a girl begins her period is now 12, according to Scientific American, down from age 14 a century ago. The average age of breast development is now 9 or 10. All of this would be bad enough if puberty were a private matter. It isn't. Nothing so immediately captures the interest of boys and men as the arrival of breasts. This puts a young girl at receiving unwanted attention from men the age of her father. Most young girls are not physiologically prepared for the sexual advances coming their way. They come to believe the myth. Since boys don't have to go through all of this, cramping and menstrual cycles and breast development and oogling eyes, it must be easier to be a boy than a girl. If they don't like all that embarrassment and attention, social media outlets encourage them to reconsider their gender. They are encouraged to bind their breasts, get this now, encouraged to bind their breasts, take puberty blockers, medications that induce chemical menopause to artificially halt puberty. After puberty blockers comes cross-dress hormones which guarantees that the girl will be infertile for life. Then comes testosterone, which gives the girl facial and bodily hair, different bone development of the nose and chin, and deepening of the voice. And once they have gone that far, they have given up the opportunity of ever having a child. Stopping puberty will also stop brain development and a higher risk of a heart attack. This has become a big regret for a young girl who has realized she made a big mistake, say at 13 years of age as an adolescent, and she wants to revert back to her biological sex. She wants to get married. She wants to have children. She wants to live a normal life, but that will never happen. Transgendered men who are biological women on testosterone as part of gender transition face a higher risk of high blood pressure, blood clots, hardening of the arteries, and heart attacks than women who choose not to go through sex change. Clearly, there are serious health risks in transitioning from one gender to another. Perhaps it is not easier to become a boy than to remain a girl. Now, we need to talk about intersex children just for a bit here. It is true that there are intersex children who have both a male and female anatomy and are referred to as hermaphrodites, a word derived from two Greek gods and goddesses, the male god Hermes and the female goddess Aphrodite. These children are born with both a penis and a vagina, as well as having both sperm cells and egg cells. Understand, we are not speaking about these unfortunate children. The time will come when they will have to have surgery, and the parent will have to decide their given sex based on early observation of the child. On the other hand, transgender children are born as normal people, and for various reasons have developed a form of mental illness that causes them to feel uncomfortable in their own body. This is important now to hear. These people do not need our scorn. They do not need our criticism. They need our mercy, and they need our love, and above all, they need Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It's an unfortunate thing what these young girls are going through. The pressure is put on someone. Now let's talk about the controllers who most influence transgenderism. There are three main influencers that encourage our youth toward a transgender lifestyle. We've already talked about social media, but I want to get into it much more so. Social media is number one. Chase Ross has become a YouTube sensation, a 29-year-old Canadian trans who has gone from female to male. He has garnered more than 10 million views and a regular audience of 166,000 subscribers on his YouTube channel, uppercase Chase What. According to Abigail, I'm quoting her now, Chase offers self-depreciating humor, advice, encouragement, and deeply personal confessions for the benefit of gender-confused adolescents. He is joyous, he's cool, he's got a septum that is a nose ring, a lip ring, and several cat tattoos. And with the help of decades of testosterone, he has an impressively black beard, broad shoulders, and apparently no fear of embarrassment. He has mostly banished his period. If you are an anxious teenage girl plagued with menstrual cramps and social anxiety, you might look upon him and say, I'll have what he is having. Trans gurus like Chase have several mantras to encourage adolescent girls to think differently about themselves. Now listen to these mantras. Listen to how the promotion comes out. If you think you might be trans, you are. Try being trans. Binders are a good way to start. Testosterone is an amazing way to solve all of your problems. If your parents loved you, they would support your trans identity. Look at this one. If you are not supported in your trans identity, you'll probably kill yourself. You better get around people to support you, otherwise you're going to commit suicide. That's the push. Those are the themes that are going out on the internet to these adolescent kids. Does that trouble you? Oh my goodness. And deceiving parents and doctors are justified if it helps transition. This is another one. Deceiving parents and doctors are justified if it helps transition. Then they say, you don't have to identify as the opposite sex to be trans. Be a non-binary or genderqueer, meaning neither male nor female, using pronouns like they or them, like the book of Genesis teaches us, you know. Being a little facetious there. Here's the startling statistic. 65% of adolescent girls who had discovered transgender identity, get this now, did so out of the blue. After a period of prolonged social media immersion, it is something they never thought of until social media came along. You know, they're pretty well content with themselves, but oh man, there must be something better out there. And so out of the blue, hey, I'm a girl, but I don't want to be a girl anymore. Furthermore, as one psychiatrist put it, adolescent girls suddenly identifying as a transgender seems to be caught up in a craze, a cultural enthusiasm that spreads like a virus. It is a cultural fad. Get this, a cultural fad promoted by social media. So here are girls getting themselves in a position where they could never have a child, never go back and be who they were, and they're just caught up in a fad. And it all comes just out of the blue, you know? Just never thought of this before, but Nick Mayo tried. So you have social media, that's number one. Number two is schools. In 2019, the policymaking arm of the California Teachers Association passed a requirement to allow trans kids aged 12 up to leave school to obtain cross-sex hormones. That means if a girl does that, she'll never be pregnant. California boasts the most comprehensive statewide gender and sexual orientation instruction, statutorily, get this now, statutorily mandated for all students enrolled in grades K through 12 and explicitly barring parental opt-out. In schools across America, kindergartners are taught that biological sex and gender are different. We're talking about kindergarten kids now. That sometimes one sex aligns with their gender and sometimes it doesn't. It's up to each individual child to begin to think what their true gender really is. Folks, we are talking about 5 and 6 year old children. Now notice this. The California Board of Education provides through its virtual libraries a book intended for kindergarten teachers to read to their students. This is mandated, whether a teacher does it or not, it's mandated. Who Are You? The Kid Guide to Gender Identity by Brooke Pessy Weatherby. The book begins, babies can't talk, so grown-ups make a guess by looking at their bodies. This is the sex assigned to you at birth, male or female. The author then runs the gamut of typical kindergarten gender identity instructions. Who are you? This is what a teacher is saying to a six-year-old kid. You could be trans, genderqueer, non-binary, gender fluid, transgender, gender neutral, agender, natrosis, bigender, third gender, two-spirit. I had no idea what some of that means. I didn't look up. What's a natrosis? What's a two-spirit? What's a third gender? Well, a third gender is them, you know.
Yes.
So.
What's gender fluid? Do you like one?
Yeah. You don't give. Every day you determine whether you're a boy or a girl. See, I'll dress as a girl today, but tomorrow I'll dress as a boy. Today I'm Ron, but tomorrow I'll be Rhonda. And the teacher has to identify me by the name I choose for the day. And if I want to be called a her, and she calls me a he, she can get fired.
Yeah. Just call them all bits.
Yeah. As I said, I don't understand the meaning of these words. It's being taught to kindergarten kids, yet kindergartners are learning what they mean, and at such an early age, you're told to question their gender. They may not be a boy or a girl, but they think they are. And folks, this is just plain evil. It's just evil. So what's pushing this? What's the agenda behind it? Well, you have social media, our school system teaching our kids this. Here's the third one, shrinks. Get all three S's here. Abigail tells a story of a woman dragging her teenage son into a therapist's office and says, "Doctor, please help. My son thinks he's a chicken." The son says, "If there is one thing I can tell you about chickens, it's that we know who we are." So the son says, "I know I'm a chicken. Every chicken knows if they're a chicken." Okay. No, the mother says, "Where is your proof? You have no feathers." "True," the son replies, "I went through the wrong puberty." The woman turns to the therapist. "You see what I mean? He's lost his mind." The therapist replies, "You're the one arguing with the chicken." What we're learning here, this is just a joke, but what we're learning is the psychiatrist has to affirm whatever that individual says they are. If they say they are a chicken, then they are a chicken. If a boy says he's a girl or a girl says she's a boy, the psychiatrist has to affirm that. It's called affirmative care. The prevailing medical standard is to accept the feeling of the trans patient as normal, and instead of helping them come to reality about themselves, they simply affirm their feelings, even at the alarm of the parents. The American Psychological Association guidelines for care of transgender and gender nonconforming is defined as transgender affirming care. So that's part of the whole American Psychological Association. That care must be respectful and supportive of the identities and life of transgender non-compliant people. Respect and support don't seem like so much to ask for, but the American Psychological Association guidelines goes much further, mandating that mental health professionals adopt gender ideology themselves. That is, if a boy thinks he's a girl or a girl thinks she is a boy, that is perfectly normal. That's perfectly normal. It's the parents who need the counseling, especially if they think their child is a chicken. Let's wrap this up. Because all of us are in the same conflict, but in a different way. That's how I want us to conclude this. It's the conflict between the brain and the body. What we have learned about trans kids is an age-old problem. It's a problem all of us face. Our lives are like a walking civil war. From the trans kids, their bodies tell them that they are a biological boy or girl. Their brain tells them they are different than their biological parts. There is for them the struggle for identity. Their body tells them they are a certain gender determined at birth. Their mind tells them they are born in the wrong body. They believe this because they've been indoctrinated by social media, by their schooling, and by shrinks who simply affirm whatever the child thinks they are, that's who they are. Dr. Randy Kaufman, a gender-affirming therapist, now get, listen to this quote, says to religious parents, talking about people like you, says to religious parents whose child has come out as trans, while the parents believe this is to be immoral, I tell them that we can't change the mind, so we have to change the body. You see, there's a conflict between brain and body. This is a different kind of warfare that you and I face on a daily basis. In our struggle to overcome sin, our struggle is between the spirit and the flesh. In Romans chapter 7, Paul speaks of this spiritual conflict, which is the very essence of human experience. He says, I know what is right. I want to do what is right. And yet somehow, I don't do what I know I should have done. I know what is wrong. I don't want to do what is wrong. Yet I did the very thing I shouldn't have done. That's Paul in Romans 7, verse 15. Paul had to admit that sin was still very present in his life, Romans 7, verse 17. Paul at times felt like a split personality. It was as if two different people were inside his skin. He found himself pulled in two different directions. He thought of himself as a walking civil war. Then Paul cries out, oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord, Romans 7, 25. Church, we're living in a different time than we were as an adolescent. When going through puberty, you might have felt insecure. You might have had struggled with your identity. You might have asked yourself, do I measure up? Am I accepted? Yet, I doubt if any of you thought you were born in the wrong body. I doubt if any of you thought you should be anyone other than who you are. We live in a different time. A day when neo-Marxism is wanting to divide the human race, to turn one against another. And Jesus warned about this. Just before he comes back a second time, he said, many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. And because of lawlessness, the love of many will grow cold. That's where we are today. In an us versus them society. These trans young people have been caught up in a political philosophy to confuse their minds and to tell them that God made a mistake when he put you in the body that you so hate. It's like you know better than God. You are not who this Christian God made you. Do you want happiness? Change your gender and all anxiety and frustration will be gone. Satan's plan today amongst the adolescents and even amongst adults is to wipe out all gender, which in turn violates the very word of God when he said, in the image of God, he created him, mankind, male and female, he created them. These confused adolescents don't need our scorn or our disgust in what they are doing to themselves. They have fallen as victims to an evil culture that will forever destroy their lives. They need our love, they need our compassion, and above all, they need Jesus Christ, who alone can transform their lives and give them security and a sense of belonging they are so desperately seeking. Wow.
Amen.
That was a hard lesson. But I hope that it gives you some concept of what our culture is really like.